Hey guys, welcome to Collider movie talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is the daily show. We give you all the latest news from the world of movies, put some insight into what it all means. Leading off the show today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the planet Earth, coming to you from right here at the Collider Video Studios here in Burbank, California. We all went out to Vegas again last night. John's came back with one less tooth.
It's true.
And a tattoo. Also here is Jon Schnepp.
That's right. I got 40 tattoos and then had them all removed.
It's a long
Sounds
day.
Painful. Plus. Also here, Jeremy Jahns.
I got 41, still trying to find out how to remove the tiger from the bathroom. Don't know.
Also here, Kristian Harloff.
What is with these intros with Ashley? It's like, I'll say Jeremy Jahns. I'll say Kristian
Sorry,
Harloff.
I was thinking about,
who else is here?
Is Ashley, that a Hangover reference? I was thinking about, is that from The Hangover, the tiger in the bathroom? I'm serious.
And also here, Wendy Lee. She's here sitting next to me.
Wendy Lee, what's that girl?
All right, guys. Well, as we do from time to time, we like to talk about a little bit of movie news. We're so glad you joined us today. So let's get on with it. Ashley, what's the first story today?
According to an exclusive report from Collider's own Steve Weintraub, writer-producer Simon Kinberg is looking to make his directorial debut with the next X-Men movie, and he's already written the screenplay. The report confirms persistent rumors that the movie will focus on the Dark Phoenix storyline, and now it's up to the studio to decide if they'll use Kinberg's script and if he'll direct. The only casting info out there now is Sophie Turner's comments on the red carpet, stating she will begin filming a new X-Men movie later this year. John, what do you think of Simon Kinberg possibly directing the next X-Men movie?
I'm a little bit torn, because on one hand, I am a big Simon Kinberg fan. I mean, this dude has his fingers in so many pies across Hollywood. Nothing, Ashley? It's...
I missed it.
That, I mean, no, seriously, he is involved. When you go down some of all of our favorite stuff, the amount of that favorite stuff that Simon Kinberg is involved in one way, shape, or form is actually kind of astounding. He's a really cool guy. I've had hung out with him in line at a Toys R Us during Star Wars Day when they were doing all the toys. He's a super cool guy, very creative. But I always get a little bit nervous when you're talking about... I remember when Roberto Orci was going to direct the Power Rangers movie.
The Star Trek movie.
And I was like, man, I love Orci, but he's never directed anything. Is a huge budget, major franchise like Star Trek the right thing to do your very first directing on? And in a situation like this, like, okay, Kinberg, seriously, he knows the universe, but just because you know the universe doesn't mean you're a good director or would be good at directing. I'm not saying he wouldn't be good at directing. He might be the next Scorsese, for all we know. I don't know. But it does always make me nervous when you're talking about getting a guy to direct the first thing he's ever directed, and it's a big, major, high-budget, high-profile franchise like X-Men. So I'll be honest with you. I love the dude, and I love his name, and I love what he's done. But I would feel a little anxious about him directing this next thing, especially considering that we're coming off of one of the weak X-Men films. X-Men Apocalypse was not one of the strong. It was certainly not a very good follow-up to the brilliance that was Days of Future Past. And so coming off a rather weak one to now go into the next chapter with a guy who's never directed so much as a soap commercial makes me a little bit nervous. I know, Schnepp, you heard about all this. What do you think?
Well, you know, I agree when you're talking about someone who's never directed anything, that's like to give them a giant budget film. But I just put it into context. He's not only been a writer, but he's been a producer of all the X-Men films, you know.
And but you've worked with producers.
Yeah.
And you're a director.
Yeah.
Producing and directing are two different things.
They are two different things. But when I see someone transitioning, I see someone transitioning from editing to directing. And I see someone from writing to directing. And I also see people from producing to directing. Because when you're in the overall mix, it's a collaborative medium and it's a collaborative effort. And a producer, especially a hands-on producer like Simon Kinberg, you'll see a list of like 30 producers on all of these movies.
Yeah.
Pretty much three of them worked on the movie. The other ones are like, you know, behind the scenes, financing or making things happen. They all produced in different ways, but Kinberg is an on-the-set type of producer. He's in the editing room. He's there. So I feel like he has his hands on at least the pulse of continuing the storyline from X-Men Apocalypse. And for me, the best part of X-Men Apocalypse was Scott Summers,
the
young Scott Summers, young Jean Grey, young Nightcrawler, all that the refreshed newer X-Men. And I wanted to see if they keep going on with that franchise. I'd like to see that. It seems like that's what they're doing. So I'm all for seeing what Simon Kinberg can do.
What do you think, Jeremy?
Yeah, it's it does seem like a Hail Mary of sorts. You know, it's like maybe they're thinking, all right, we're coming off one of the, you know, not the stronger X-Men movie. I enjoyed Apocalypse for what it was, but I agree it was not Days of Future Past. And then, yeah, to give it to someone who's never directed before, he has written before. He has some name, his name on some good writing. He has his name on some garbage scripts. He's done both out there. But usually, yeah, you'd like to see, oh, hey, do this little indie film first, then we'll see where you're going. Even Peter Jackson, who had a filmography when he wanted to do King Kong, studio was like, how about you do that Lord of the Rings thing that no one's really asking for, no one really cares about, and if it bombs, no one's really hurting for it, and then you can do King Kong afterwards. Usually a studio will go, hey, do A, and then you can get B. So the fact that they're giving it to him right out the gate, maybe there's going to be a really strong assistant producer is going to kind of like babysit him, I have no idea. I feel like there's not enough information. John, if we were in Vegas, I wouldn't know what the other person's hand is. All I know is what the hand is here, and I wouldn't put a solid bet on giving a first-time director the X-Men franchise for the Phoenix Saga, because I want to see the Phoenix Saga for all intents and purposes. We've not actually seen the Phoenix Saga on screen yet. We haven't. Even though people would argue we have not. So I'm interested, but I'm nervous.
Christian, look, there could be two different ways of looking at this. The one is, the one I kind of sign on, which is like, let him cut his teeth on something that's not the X-Men at first. Or is there merit to the idea of throw him into the water and see if he can swim with something like this? Because, look, when it comes to, he may not have directed anything, but Simon Kinberg is a name that's associated with the X-Men. Which way do you fall on this?
I fall the same way I did with Dave Filoni when it comes to Rebels, Star Wars Rebels. And with your example of Orsi, I think that one made me nervous because he didn't have the type of experience that Simon Kinberg does. Simon Kinberg is, I think anxious is a perfect word, but I think excited could be another word, because if you look at what he has done, and look, to throw into that anxious, don't forget, a lot of people don't realize that he's done the Phoenix before. He wrote the Brett Ratner, the X-Men 3, he wrote that one. And people give him a pass on it because he's done so many great things since then. But I don't really feel all the writing had for that particular script was the problem, because I think that Ratner changed up a lot of stuff in there. So I give him the pass on it. What I will say is that he's been involved in a lot of projects that I do get excited about. Now, whether it's a television series like Star Wars Rebels or if it's a great movie like The Martian, he's got his hands on a lot of things. And he's been around. He is everywhere, and this is a guy who knows everyone, and he's a student of the games that he plays in, whether it's producing or writing, and now directing is something this is not something that just came about, hey, who should direct the next one? What if we give it a Kinberg? This has been something in the works for a very long time, and I think that it's, whether or not this particular movie, it's him getting, he knows the X-Men. He's been a part of the X-Men franchise for a very long time, so I think it's a risk for sure. I mean, there's no one's going to argue that, but I think it's a guy that this makes sense to take the type of risk, because he is someone who understands the property, and people are going to throw stuff back. He's also he was involved in Fantastic Four. He's been involved with things that did not work. But we haven't seen what his director eye can do. I want to see him do it. I think that it's time for someone who knows the franchise that can do it. And I also think, don't be surprised that you're going to hear him involved in the Boba Fett movie when it is announced. Whether you want it or not, I don't necessarily want it. He's going to be involved in that, probably writing and producing it with Dave Filoni as the director. Take it to the bank.
Let me ask you guys a question. Is it safe to say that we would at least all agree on this, that we would all feel better about this situation were we to hear that before, because we know that this isn't going to shoot until at least later in the year. If we heard that before that, Kinberg's taken on and is going to direct this $35 million film that Lionsgate's going to put out or something like that, that he's directing that first and then doing X-Men, would that make you feel better or make no difference to you whatsoever?
No difference to me, yeah. Because like I'm agreeing with Christian. He's got the experience. He's been working in the X-Men universe pretty much since it started. Cool. And I feel like directing is the next step for him, especially with them wanting to keep the same cast and moving forward. I'm sure Bryan Singer gave his blessing and is probably executive producing. You know, I think it makes sense if they're going to keep moving forward with that version of the X-Men to keep it Simon Kinberg involved.
Let him take a crack at it, yeah. Man. Let him take a crack at the big game, because it's not like his writing and producing career is not going to take a hit. It's like,
no,
yeah, now the studio
not
doesn't want, that doesn't mean the studio wants to just throw away money on somebody, but if them taking the risk and putting in this, go for it. Go for the big one, because if he delivers on his first one on an X-Men movie, he just won a championship.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because like we all said, Apocalypse, I'm with you. I didn't mind Apocalypse. Yeah. But it wasn't as revered as everyone else thought, Days of Future Past was. But if he's the guy in his first attempt, comes back and makes a kick-ass X-Men movie, then sky's the limit.
However, in terms of building up the hype on the studio end of it, if this guy directed a smaller picture that crushed and was really good, then his name would have people really jacked for it. But right now, I feel like a lot of people are going to be apprehensive. Like, I don't know the guy, so I guess we'll see what happens.
But see, I don't know, though, because he's a rare thing. Simon Kinberg is like similar to like Max Landis. He is a guy that people recognize his name as a screenwriter. And yes, he's got a lot of producer credits too. But to be fair, there are a lot of writers, you don't know who they are. Simon Kinberg is not one of those guys. Kinberg is a name that you recognize. You know them. If you're following the space enough, you keep hearing Kinberg's name. That's why he's getting this shot, because he is a guy that keeps getting his name out there and people know who he is.
I just want to propose an argument or an alternative view of it. I feel like outside this building, at least in the other populist pockets of the United States who are X-Men movie fans, I don't feel like a lot of people know who this guy is.
Fan-wise, maybe not, right. But that's not what's important right now. It's about getting your voice inside of this studio in general, and to build your reputation up there to where he's got enough of a reputation. Simon Kinberg is a name in this industry. So like if Kinberg's saying, I want to take a crack at it, and his relationship with Fox clearly knows who he is. You know what I mean? Fox knows. It's not just like some screenwriter coming in who's made a name for himself by one project. This is a guy who's been around producing tons of stuff. He's got his hands in Fox. He's got his hands in Lucasfilm. He is someone who has a name in the industry.
I just feel like the path that we have seen starting to be executed in the business is the better, wiser, safer, and probably more advantageous path. We just heard that Shazam might have its new director. Nice. What did that guy do? Directed some short films online. Then went up and did a small budget horror film thing. He cut his teeth. He showed he knows what he's doing. He's got some actual directing experience that he can now take that directing experience and use on Shazam. We just went to go see Get Out last night, the first directorial effort by Jordan Peele. Mm-hmm. A low budget, smaller film with less stakes. He's cut his teeth on that. And now when he goes on to a bigger film, he'll have that directing experience on top of his other tool set that he can bring into that. My nerves here about Simon Kinberg is he would be, if this works out and if they sign it, and let's make it really clear, this isn't a signed deal yet. But if he does, he's going to be going into X-Men, not only having not directed anything before, he will have no directing experience that which he can mine and use that is his own directing experience, like Jordan Peele's going to have, like the guy who did Lights Out is going to have. He'll have none of that experience that he can draw on to use an X-Men. And I think that makes me a little bit nervous.
Let me add that, you know, he's been on set for like 15 years behind a director, watching directors direct.
Yeah, but so's Rob Schneider.
Well, that's different, though. I think it's different. Like,
it's a big difference. I would not compare Rob Schneider to Simon Kinberg. Jordan Peele
has been a guy who's traditionally made his name at comedy so far. Younger guy, younger than Kinberg. And maybe this was a particular movie, Get Out, was something that he was looking forward to doing in this genre. He hasn't been around a franchise the way this guy is. This guy has been married to the X-Men franchise
for a very long time.
Correct. But I'm just saying, the experience between the two of them is vastly different.
All right. Well, we want to know, what do you guys think? Do you fall on the one side of maybe get Kinberg to direct something else first and cut his teeth, get some experience to make X-Men better? Or do you feel like this guy's been around enough movies, he knows his thing, throw him into the deep water and let's see what he can do? Leave your thoughts in the comment section. We want to know what you guys think. All right, what's next?
In an exclusive report from IndieWire, Martin Scorsese's $100 million gangster movie, The Irishman, starring Robert De Niro, has been scooped up by Netflix and is in the process of closing a deal to release it to its 93 million subscribers in over 190 countries. The movie was going to be backed by Paramount Pictures, but after head of studio Brad Grey stepped down, Scorsese's team put together a new package. The Irishman details the life of Frank the Irishman, a hitman best known for his supposed involvement in the death of Jimmy Hoffa. No official release date has been revealed. Jeremy, thoughts about Martin Scorsese's The Irishman debuting on Netflix?
This is interesting to me. This tears me in two directions. I can see this in two different ways, and that's why I like the table discussion, so we can all talk about it. On one, you can see it as a big move, like, oh, Netflix and the streaming services are now scooping up really big-name directors to have their movies on their platform. That's a big move. That's a big deal. That's awesome. Or you could see it as, well, apparently when a director makes a movie that no one watches, like Silence, even Martin Scorsese has to have his movie, his next movie, come out on a streaming platform because it's not going to get a theatrical release. So I don't know which one this falls under, but I do find it interesting because in the end, Adam Sandler's last movie, I think, came out on Netflix. So
his last three movies
came out on Netflix. Yeah, right. So I don't know what to see. I feel like the lack of people who went and saw Silence is really why this happened, but that's just me. Here we go. What do you guys think?
I think you're right. There are a couple ways to think about it. The first one that went to me is this is an important mm-hmm. piece of news, and here's why. Because all that notwithstanding, Netflix has had major movie stars debut their movies on Netflix, but they have all been bags of shit. I mean, it's been Adam Sandler, and those movies are the bottom of the barrel, like nearly as bad as the one where he played his own sister, which I can't even remember.
Jack and Jill. Play Twister with your sister.
like seriously, the ones he put out on Netflix have been pretty much on par with those. They've been terrible. Then there was that one Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon sequel, mm-hmm. but that was like 8 years after the original one, and there wasn't a lot of interest and all that kind of stuff. So this is the first. It's Scorsese bringing a film of his. So regardless of anything else, that's important. Okay, going back to what you said, that's exactly what was the first thing that went through my head. It was the double whammy of, number one, this is a commentary on Gray, who's leaving Paramount, and a vote of no confidence in them that this was a bad one to go with. We don't think this one has any market appeal. We don't think this one's going to work. I'm speculating here, by the way. That they're looking at this project and saying, we don't think it has market appeal. We think it's going to do less business than what Silence was. Even if it is a good script, we don't think it's going to do any business. He's greenlit it, but he's gone now, and now we can kind of part ways with it. And, you know, going into the whole thing about, is this another matter where the producers of the film are realizing, we're not going to make bank in the theater with this. Netflix is offering us $175 million for the rights of the film, whatever. This is financially the right place to go. We won't really know until we see the movie, but whether it's for good reasons or bad reasons, this is significant and important and could shake things up a lot moving forward.
And hearing the Paramount did say that we don't know if it's going to market it, because it's certainly possible. I can see the Netflix guys doing the Pacino and going, morons, because it's a gangster film, again with Scorsese and De Niro and potentially Pacino. And this story, this changes the game, because when you look at the Adam Sandler movies and stuff that you guys are bringing up, you had Adam Sandler, a guy who was pretty much kind of flailing in the box office, and he takes his friends, he puts them in movies, and there's no really big stars. Scorsese, to quote Leonardo DiCaprio, is still making punk rock at his age. And when you have him again doing a gangster film, this also shows what Netflix is able to do with their budgets. The fact that how much money they make with all their TV shows, and now they're able to take it and say, we have the next Scorsese film. That is game-changing, because it absolutely has to deal with Scorsese saying to himself, all right, Silence didn't get the run that it should have. And it also has this, like, well, this is a different thing. Imagine the limitations. He likes to work with big, like, three-hour movies and stuff, too. He can make whatever he wants to make at Netflix. Now, whether that's a good or bad thing, we'll find out. But he's going to be able to do it. And the marketing behind it. Netflix's marketing is second to none. It's incredible. You're going to get way better marketing than you got from this movie than you did Silence. Mm-hmm. And because of I think that one of the what Netflix is also going to do, they're going to take all the international distribution, everything, they're going to do everything themselves. They're going to put all the eggs in this basket, because this, if this works for them, getting Scorsese, you're going to see the floodgates open. More and more movies are going to go to, again, whether or not that is a good or a bad thing, that's something we'll discuss down the line. But this is something different. This is a bigger story than I think we realize.
I realize it. I think it's massive. I was so happy to hear this news. When you say 93 million people now have the access to watch this film, 93 million people are going to watch this film. It's people who didn't go see Silence. A lot of people are not going out to the movie theaters now because of the budget, the price that it costs to go see one film. You have families having to make those decisions. You have people like, well, I can go see one movie a month. And we go see movies all the time. We're not in the norm where people have a budget that they have to really figure out one movie a month, maybe two movies a month. This would not be in there. You're right. The Irishman, for us, or people who love gangster films, yes, but this is like unlimited freedom. Netflix, the way they operate, they just let you do it. We don't have a production studio. We're hiring you to make the thing. You bring it back when it's done. That's the golden ticket. I mean, this is the new Zoetrope Studios. It's called Netflix. I could see tons of amazing, talented directors flooding. I mean, they've already had out Beasts of No Nation, if you remember that film. Yeah. They had Fukunaga do that film. They've already done a lot of amazing one-off films. This is just now them. Now we're getting the big money because idiots like Paramount fumbled. you're exactly right. It's their loss. It's Netflix's gain.
I don't know if I can agree with that on that. With the Paramount fumbled. Look, Silence. Silence. No, let's put an actual number to it. Silence made $7 million.
It's box office. It's about missionaries.
It's Martin Scorsese, Liam Neeson, Andrew Garfield with all the Academy Award buzz, and we're not saying it made $37 million. It made $7 million.
Nobody wanted to see it.
The
I understand
last
that.
Time,
Wolf of Wall Street crushed though.
The yeah. last Wolf of Wall Street
and
crushed.
Now it's Paramount and Scorsese.
But the last time that De Niro and Pacino made a movie together, back when anybody actually cared to see a De Niro Pacino movie together, and there's a good possibility we may see both of those guys in this movie,
Nightfall,
was 9 years ago in Righteous Kill.
And it was a horrible
right.
film.
It was really
look,
bad.
They did which two made, movies back
which,
to back, which were
which
bad.
Made like, yeah. like $30 or $40 million at the U.S. box office. Now, we're 9 years after that. I just got to say, I don't know. When you look at the recent gangster movies that have come out as well, I don't know that Paramount was wrong to think, we don't think this thing can make a lot of money at the box office at this point. When you actually look at the facts and you look at the data that's in front of them.
Sure.
Could it be a good move for Netflix, though? It might have been their only move is to go to Netflix. But here's the thing. Netflix is going to spend big money on this. The question will be, will it actually end up paying off for them? And like I know you mentioned that 93 million on Netflix, 93 million people are going to watch it.
Well,
no, they're not.
Sure.
I mean, it'll really depend. We'll have to wait and see if this works for them because they're putting out a lot of money right now to take these gambles and risks. And I love that Netflix is taking these gambles and risks. But if it doesn't work out for them, they're not going to be throwing out these $150 million checks moving forward, at least a year or two from now, unless it works. But that's why, because it's such an interesting risk, that this is really significant news. This is big. Yeah. If a Scorsese film can go to Netflix, and if it can work on Netflix, then absolutely the situation you describe is going to happen.
And I do agree with you. I'm not saying, like, when I say Paramount fumble, that's my opinion. I do agree that they were like, look, the money that we can make back in the theater, they ran some numbers, we're probably not going to do what we need to do to make this money back. For Netflix, it's already a done deal. They have a subscription base. So they can take those kinds of chances that big studios can't.
We also don't know if Paramount actually said all this stuff, too. Because remember, the other thing is, too, Scorsese has also been, minus this year, has been a guy that you put a movie out and you're going to get some potential Oscar nominations, which brings a lot of recognition to the studios. Now, if Netflix does do this, this is potential what they could do, and they release it in a couple of theaters in December.
Oh, they will.
They can be. They will. And they could be... potentially have a best Oscar, a best picture winner, or at least nominee if things go right.
Next year,
if it
you're
can be
see
as
that,
good
yeah.
as Righteous Kill.
Oh, wait. I don't know why you brought that up.
All right, let's move on. Listen, guys, we reached our part of the show now for buy or sell. Here's how this works. In front of her ass, she's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Ashley, what do we got?
A few weeks ago, Guillermo del Toro took to Twitter to gauge interest for Hellboy 3, and after reaching 100,000 votes on Twitter, agreed to arrange a sit-down with star Ron Perlman and comic creator Mike Mignola to discuss a potential sequel. Now it appears that meeting happened, and the outcome is not exactly what fans expected. Taking to Twitter with an update, del Toro relayed the news, saying, Hellboy 3, sorry to report, spoke with all parties, must report that 100% the sequel will not happen. And that is to be the final thing about it. Schnepp, do you buy or sell a Hellboy 3 ever getting off the ground, or is it dead and gone?
Well, I buy 100% what Guillermo said. I was one of those 100,000 people who upvoted because I want to see a Hellboy 3. Yeah. I know that they had big ideas and a big budget attached to Hellboy 3 because it escalated from Hellboy 1 to 2 to 3. It had to go into that big budget territory, and unfortunately, getting that kind of big budget money for this film, the series, which didn't make that kind of money back, or at least enough money to validate the kind of budget they want. But if he was actually meeting with Mike Mignola and Perlman, and they all kind of came to the conclusion that they can't make the film, they're going to just stop talking about it, move on to other projects. I'm sad to hear that, but unfortunately I buy it, especially if it's coming from Guillermo, because Guillermo never gives up on any projects that he wants to make unless they cannot be made. And he just finally said, that one's not being made. He's not giving up on all the other projects.
What do you think, Jeremy?
That is a bummer. Yeah, I buy that it happened because truthfully it happened. I sell that it happened because I wanted to see Hellboy 3 also, because Hellboy was one of the surprise movies. The trailer looked like garbage. This kid's like, ooh, ah, ooh, crazy world. It looked like it was going to revolve around him. It didn't. It revolved around Hellboy. So I loved Hellboy, and I enjoyed Hellboy 2. I wanted to see a Hellboy 3. I think Guillermo del Toro... the movies he makes, just the contrast and the color palette of it, I think it's just appealing. It has good humor, action. It's a bummer, it really is, that we're not going to see Hellboy 3. I would have loved a Hellboy trilogy, and I have to wonder if the marketing behind it is like, well, it's not part of a cinematic universe. Well, that can't happen in this day and age, I'm sorry to say. Don't know. That's just what I have to now figure out in my head. Bummed out. But yes, I buy that that conversation happened. I'm sorry, Guillermo del Toro. Schnepp and I tried.
Yeah, I buy that it happened. And look, we've known forever that this was never going to happen. About 3 years ago, when Guillermo del Toro came out and said he had a vision for Hellboy 3, and it was going to be, and he wouldn't do it for anything less than $200 million. Yeah. Okay, you know what Hellboy 2 made? Put this in perspective. A $200 million budget movie, you roughly, in the neighborhood, you need your movie to make about $450 million at the box office to break even. All right? So he wants to do Hellboy. The last Hellboy movie domestically made $75 million. Yeah. There was nobody anywhere that was going to give him $200 million to make a film. And Guillermo del Toro, to his credit, he's like, he sticks to his creative guns. That's the vision I have for this movie, and that's what it would cost. He wasn't going to move off that. And, you know, a while ago, Legendary, remember the CEO of Legendary said he met with del Toro to talk about it, said, that sounds great. We can't pay for it, but that sounds great. If you can go find somebody to pay for it, that's great. And so for about 3 years, we knew this would never happen. This is just kind of the final nail in the coffin. And it sucks because I love the Hellboy character, but just the math doesn't work out.
I mean, I'll buy the meeting, but sell that it's ever going to happen. It's just, it's not going to happen. And I actually like two better than one. And I liked both of them. I liked both of them a lot. I don't want to see a third one. I don't need to see a third one. There's nothing, I can't, when I think back about it, do I think that they were cool movies, and do I think that I was enjoying every second of it? I don't remember a lot about as far as, oh, what do I want to see next happen in this franchise? It's not something I've been calling for, and I think it's not something that a lot of people have been calling for, because like you said, $75 million on what, 85 or $90 million budget, and Del Toro, who is a great filmmaker, seems to do this a lot with these movies. Even Pacific Rim had a really inflated budget, and that was one of the main things, how much, and he even said it when we went to see it, WonderCon one year. He's talking about the money that he wanted. Like you said, he's got a vision. He's that type of director. He's not just spending money to spend money. He's got an idea of what he wants to do. He goes big, but unfortunately, they don't make the kind of money that warrants those kind of budgets. So if you're a studio head, you're just going, we can't, that doesn't make sense to do that. So I don't think it'll happen. I think that you can watch the first two. They're both really good movies. I want to see Del Toro do more stuff. I want to see what his vision, what that brilliant mind is going to do next. And I don't think it should be Hellboy 3.
All right, what's next?
Warner Brothers has released a new trailer for director Guy Ritchie's fantasy action movie, King Arthur, Legend of the Sword. The retelling of the classic tale stars Charlie Hunnam as Arthur, a reimagining of the once and future king who must battle his uncle Vortigern, played by Jude Law, to reclaim the right to the throne. The film also stars Eric Bana and Jaimin Hansu and opens in theaters on May 12, 2017. Christian, buy or sell the new trailer for King Arthur Legend of the Sword.
I have sold every single trailer of this movie that has come out so far, and I almost sold this one. I'm going to buy it, and I almost sold it because of the Zeppelins, who I love. I know it's a Guy Ritchie movie, and I know that it would make sense that Guy Ritchie would put Zeppelin there, but it took me out of the movie because of the trailer. Because as I'm watching the trailer, it was the best imagery I've seen so far, and it was the best part of the Arthur story that I saw, that I wasn't jarred with Guy Ritchie's style, that I felt like, oh, this is what this movie's going to be. I'm buying that I'm in this time, and then Zeppelin kicks in, and I was like, I get that it's Guy Ritchie, but just let me stay in this time period. And I felt like I was out of it, and this might just be my personal thing. Modern music and those types of things, I'd never like when they do it. I don't like when Kanye's in the Assassin's Creed stuff, any of that stuff. So the trailer itself, though, for what I saw, I'm buying, because it was the first time that I was actually interested in the story, and I don't want to let a song take me out of that, because I actually was interested in the details of this particular trailer.
Well, you were buying the trailer in spite of. I am buying the trailer because of. That actually, the music, the reason I like the music in there, which normally I would not have, because I totally see where you're coming from, but for me, it puts Guy Ritchie's thumbprint on the trailer. And it really does communicate, this is not going to be your dad's King Arthur movie. This is going to be a very different kind of King Arthur. And by putting just a piece of music like that in there, it really put the explanation point on for me and fits in with what I consider to be Guy Ritchie's flavor, which I generally really love. We're talking about the guy who did Lock, Stock, and Snatch, one of my favorite movies. So, yeah, I'm really big on this, so I buy the trailer.
Yeah, I hadn't bought a trailer for King Arthur yet, and I'm buying it. The music didn't bother me. I thought the music was, you know, it was fun in the movie, but for some reason I was locked into what the imagery was and the story I was seeing. This dude who was king, who's supposed to be king, they don't know he's king. He pulls the sword out of the stone. It looks like he doesn't want it. Chucks it in the water. Destiny's going to find him. It was the first time in a trailer there was like a cohesive story mm-hmm. within the trailer that I actually could grab onto and go, oh, okay, that's why I want to see the movie. So, I mean, the music could have been that. It actually probably could have been a Kanye song, and I would have been like, yeah, but the story looks good, so I'll latch onto that one. So I'm buying the trailer for sure.
My question for you guys, what's the exact line again from Holy Grail? Well, you think she gets supreme executive power because he pulled some cutlery from a rocker? Something like that.
I don't remember the exact line.
You have supreme executive power. Okay, anyway, what do you think, Schnapp?
You know what? I'm going to buy this trailer, too. I was with Christian. I didn't like the last couple trailers. But the visual imagery, yeah. When I first started, I was like, is this Zeppelin? Yeah, it's Zeppelin. Kind of threw me a little bit. But I'm a big fan of John Borman's Excalibur. I've always wanted to see Camelot 3000, the futuristic DC version of King Arthur. I'd love to see that. Of course, I want to see a lot of things, but they're not going to happen. So this movie that is happening, I actually kind of, I can't help but buy it, even though I really thought the last two trailers sucked. Seeing all this new imagery and also seeing the magical elements, because the other two trailers didn't really have enough magical elements for me, Lady in the Lake. Mm. These are the things that are part of the lore of King Arthur, and I was like starting to worry, like, it's gonna just be some stupid realistic retelling of King Arthur. You can't do that. The sword and the stone is automatically goofy. Yeah. It has to have the elements of magic. So that I saw it done, but in the Guy Ritchie style, especially in this trailer, sold me on. I was like, all right, now I wanna see the film.
All right, what's next?
According to Variety, Bloodline's Kyle Chandler is set to join Stranger Things' Millie Bobby Brown as her father in Godzilla, King of the Monsters. Krampus Helmer Michael Dougherty is directing the movie and wrote the script with Zach Shields. Plot details are unknown at this time, but the movie will continue to set up its shared universe tie-in with King Kong. Godzilla, King of Monsters, is set for release on March 22, 2019, with Godzilla vs. Kong slated the following year on May 29, 2020. John Byersel, Kyle Chandler in Godzilla, King of Monsters.
I buy it, but not super enthusiastically. Look, the last time I saw a Godzilla movie where a really great actor was cast in the film to be the father of the key character, that dude didn't end up being in the film very much, so why get excited about it? So, Chandler's a tremendous actor. I'm glad he's in it. I give it a buy, just not enthusiastically.
I agree with you 100%. You buy it because, like you say, you know, it's never a bad thing to add talent. The guy's super talented. I think he was a father in Super 8, wasn't he, also?
Yes.
I think.
Ooh,
So he's a great on-screen dad, but is Godzilla cast? Yes? Okay, I'm in.
Yeah, it's one of those things where, yeah, he's a fine actor. What's he going to be in the Godzilla movie? Don't know. But if he is going to be there minimally and it's going to concentrate on the kid, I'm glad possibly we get more of the kid, because I think all the kids from Stranger Things deserve a lot more. I think this is the beginning of their career, so I'm glad she's in it.
Yeah. Watch Bloodlines. That's the only reason I would say Kyle Chandler. I mean, yeah, Bryan Cranston. If you don't, are dead in 5 seconds. I don't care. Get a big check, dude. That's all I could say.
All right, what's next?
Filming on The Predator, the highly anticipated fourth film in the Predator franchise, directed by Shane Black, is officially underway. And to mark the occasion, the writer-director unveiled the first look at the full cast. Black had a supporting role in the first Predator movie and shared the photo via Twitter, revealing that this is only a partial cast thus far and saying they are beautiful human beings, good people, also killers. Cameras roll today. In a follow-up tweet, Black also confirmed that his Predator movie will in fact be rated R. And just to be clear, PG-13 is for pussies. Spines bleed a lot. Jeanette Virus sell the cast and our rating for Shane Black's The Predator.
Well, sorry. One second. I was reading a note from somebody here. What was Shane Black saying, Ashley?
He said that PG-13 was for pussies.
Oh, okay. Good to know. Yeah. All right.
You know what? I buy Shane Black's quote 100%. I'm very happy to hear The Predator, which has to be a rated R, is rated R. The cast photo, I just wish it was like in virtual reality, you know, VR, so I could move over and see Dutch. Because you know Arnold Schwarzenegger is just right outside of the framing. It's like the other characters are just outside of this photo. I mean, the cast photo, they look, you know, they're like doing their badass faces, like, you know, bring it kind of faces. And they're all going to die horribly by the on the hands of the Predator, spines being ripped out slowly, blood shooting across a lens. And maybe even that kid gets his head ripped off.
Do you remember... I think they had just announced that Shane Black was going to direct Predator, and you and I were at a party at Skybar, and who comes in and sits right beside us? But Shane Black. Remember that?
I don't.
It was for the party for the Geeky Awards. We were at the Skybar.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
And then Shane Black comes and gets to the booth right beside us. We ended up talking with Shane Black.
That doesn't help when I'm blackout drunk.
I was about to say, you were so drunk.
So hammered.
You were so drunk.
Thank you for reminding me. Hi, Shane Black. I guess I met you.
You were probably like, you know what I got to say? Yeah. PG-13 is for pussies. He was like,
that's right.
You actually made this happen, Schnepp, and you have no idea.
He scheduled it. This tweet for 2 years later.
That's right.
Right. Yeah, just like post, like, yeah, it's a timed post. I'm glad it's rated R because a Predator movie should be rated R. The set photo does kind of crack me up because it looks like military might, adult, Paddington Bear. Like, he's just like this kid. It's just right there.
Where's my mom?
And you hear that he's going to be a lead in this movie? I just feel like
he's going to be the only one that survives.
Right.
Like, everybody in that picture.
This is going to be the most violent Home Alone movie you've ever seen in your life. I'm telling you. The photo cracks me up, but all in all, I'm glad it's rated R.
Come on, let's be honest. Why are you going in to see? You're going to see me, Dutch. You'll see the kid with the raincoat. Didn't they say that Arnold's not in this thing?
I think I heard them confirm that.
Like the other day,
he's going to be in it.
Cumberbatch is not Khan.
Well, I know.
Come on. We know he's in it.
It's the
choppa.
This movie, the image and everything, too, that everybody's saying, I'm going to buy it. It has to be rated R movie. Shane Black doesn't know how to do anything except rated R movies. The first four lines of dialogue, we're rated R. But I like the cast. I like the, including Tremblay, I think was so good in Room. I'm just nervous because I don't know what the hell we're getting ourselves into. Like, because like there was the rumors of the suburb stuff, and I'm not going to be able to say whether or not I buy or sell the movie in general until I see the first full trailer, and then I'm going to see it. And I'm going to say to myself, okay, because I know that he gets it. I know he understands it. I know he was part of the first movie. I think he helped co-write it. He understands what we want again from a Predator movie. If there's a guy that's going to save the Predator franchise, it's going to be Shane Black. It could be Shane Black. And I'm not going to just say, oh, well, that guy does comedy, so he can't be in the movie. That's not true at all. So I have to see footage, which I'm sure we're going to see sooner than later. I'm still optimistic.
I appreciate your grand scope vision, but in keeping it in the pocket, the fact now, just all we're talking about, it's rated R. You buy that?
Oh, of course I buy that.
Okay,
yeah.
Predator, Home Alone.
Yeah, you know, I'm telling you, if Arnold's in it, he's going to be like Gary Busey in Predator 2, where he knows everything. He's like, the lions.
I'm still on the bus with
Predator
talking about.
The tigers, the bears, oh my.
All right, guys. Well, listen, I want to remind you that this is not the only show that's dropping on Collider Video today. A whole bunch of other stuff is dropping as well a little bit later today. Actually, yes, today at 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, the brand new episode of Nightmares goes live at 1 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Make sure you tune in and check that out. Also, yesterday, a brand new movie trivia schmodown between Rotten Tomatoes and What the Flick went up. Check that out as well. A brand new crash course with this guy, Jeremy Johns, on everything you need to know about the Joker was put online the other day. So keep your eyes open for that. Also, I want to let you guys know that this guy, Jeremy Jahns, does another show for the Verizon Go 90 network called Awesome Tacular with Jeremy Jahns. It's a very different show from anything else we do. Once again, it's on Verizon Go 90, but you can also see episodes of the show that are on 1 or 2 week delay on the front page of our YouTube channel. You'll see we have an Awesome Tacular playlist there. Again, those episodes are 1 to 2 weeks late. Mm-hmm. The newest episodes are always up on Verizon Go 90. But we thought, why don't we give you a little bit of a taste about what's in Awesome Tacular? And you know what? Not a lot of people know that you were doing like trailer reactions and everything like right back in the early days of the internet.
Absolutely. Yeah. Me and my buddy and I, we got together, you know, we were movie fans and we were reacting before it was cool. I'm telling you, this is how we roll.
Let's check that out. This is from Awesome Tacular.
Well, What up, everybody? I'm your boy, DJJ.
I'm Kenny Zock.
And we are movie fans, and we're fans for you. We're gonna watch some movies. What we have here is the first preview for the new Star Wars movie. This is gonna break the game.
Star Wars Episode One, The Phantom Menace. It's like a preview tease of the big movie that's gonna come out in 1999.
It's like ever since we were kids, we were like,
Jeremy!
What, Ma, what?
We're playing with the camcorder.
We're talking to our friends. We'll be down in 5 minutes.
Your father's retirement speech is on there. Be careful.
Ah, Ma.
Pray before George Lucas.
That's right. You ready to go to church?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
How long did it take you to download that? 22 hours?
It was about 4 days.
Oh, okay.
That's Dagobah, baby.
You think that's Dagobah?
That's absolutely
Dagobah. Dude, that's
Dagobah.
Like a Yoda.
I know
Dagobah. That's like a Yoda riding a dinosaur. Right. Tatooine, Tatooine, we got Tatooine!
Oh! I think Obi-Wan was like a super, like,
he probably went there to, like, buy his hut. Dude, that CGI looks tight. That dude is hella real, man. I mean, I'm cool with Natalie Portman being cast. Like, Lacey Chabert might have been my choice.
Yoda is a puppet. That's amazing.
I think that guy in the cape is Darth Vader's dad, yo.
And I couldn't be prouder.
Ah! Ah! George Lucas is back!
The Force is a spiritual thing, man. You can't, like, put science to it. You can't explain
that's
it.
That's what makes it
and
cool.
And I think that's what Samuel L. Jackson's there for.
Right.
This could be the first R-rated Star Wars. That's this not. One's going to be nonstop action. You can see right from the beginning. There's not going to be a lot of wasted time talking. There's not going to be figuring things out.
I think that duck with the ears is going to be somehow detrimental.
I was reading in Cinescape magazine last month that that character's named Jar Jar Binks. He's like the mentor guide to this whole adventure.
One thing that can beat that is this. You just motorboat that S. It's coming after you, baby.
Dude, I've never motorboated, but I wouldn't want to now. Right? So glad I quit my job to wait for tickets, man.
I don't even have a job. Ma lets me crash here. It's totally...
Jeremy, enough of that! Stop talking into the movie camera!
Ma, this is important,
dinner,
George!
Okay, I called his mom. He can stay for dinner.
You can stay for dinner.
Is it goulash?
All right, so that's Awesometacular, a little taste of Awesometacular with Jeremy Jahns. Make sure you check out all the newest episodes on the Verizon Go 90 app or on the Verizon Go 90 website, or you can check out old episodes, archived episodes, on the playlist on the front page of our channel. Okay, with all that out of the way, I'm going to remind you that we're going to take a look at some live questions via Twitter at the end of the show. You can start sending in some live questions right now. Just make sure you're following us on Twitter at Collider Video. Wendy will pick a couple out near the end. But we do have a couple of mailbag questions. We're going to skip the first one because we're running out of time. Let's just go right to the second one. Ashley, what's the mailbag?
Brandon writes, hey, Collider crew. My question is about the best directing category at the Oscars. Why does the Academy nominate dramas for best directing when directing action is much harder? I completely understand why La La Land and Hacksaw Ridge were nominated for directing, but isn't directing an action movie like Civil War harder than directing a drama like Manchester by the Sea? Thanks.
Not necessarily, because not anybody can do it well, but you can have a guy's fight and whatever, but you're not necessarily developing character or plot or whatever. Sometimes action isn't that, and quite often, it's not the director who directs the action sequences. Quite often, directors have their assistant directors or their other people come in and actually their second unit directors who direct the action sequence and stuff like that. Sometimes they direct it themselves, but oftentimes they don't. So it's not necessarily harder to do than... Look, you know what's harder to do? Here's a great example. I think it was Tom Hooper directed King's Speech. Mm-hmm. There's a scene in the King's Speech that is just one of the best scenes in the past 10 years. And all it is, it's Colin Firth with Jeffrey Rush sitting in a room in two leather chairs facing each other. And the scene is like 10 minutes long, and it's just them talking. For you to direct that scene and to make it completely engaging, that you are just riveted to the screen with just that, that's directing. That's amazing. It's not to take away how difficult it is to do action or anything at all. It's just that don't necessarily try to equate one with the other. Schnepp, how would you address that?
Well, yeah, they're two completely different animals. I mean, one is communicating with the actors, getting them into the emotional part of the scene that they're in, because a lot of movies are shot out of order. You know, you walk out of a door and you're 3 months later shooting the sequence outside where you're, you know, saying hi to the person. So you have to be in the same headspace, get that kind of performance out of the actors and actresses that you're working with. And action is really choreography, and most action is done with, you know, you might have heard of G-Unit. There's a thing called B-Unit. It was, if you watch all those credits, you see, you know, exterior shots, driving scenes. Those are all different. Just, hey, go get me, the shot of the house, or they're driving, or exteriors. There's also the entire choreography of action. Like in Civil War, they brought on the John Wick directors to help with the choreography and the shooting of all those action scenes. In fact, most big budget films have three sets going on live the entire time, and the actual directors are checking in via monitors and looking at shots from far away, from miles away, okaying certain scenes as the B unit and C unit directors direct those sequences, and a lot of those are action. So if directors are afforded the time to be able to shoot all of the sequences themselves, which usually is not the case on any of the big budget films, because they're like trying to get a lot of stuff done in a limited amount of time. You hear about films all the time being like, oh, they're shooting for 60 days. That's an incredible amount of time when you think about how most films are like, have an 18-day schedule. I mean, there's just, everything breaks down to like a lot of people, I always like to remind people that filmmaking is collaborative. It's a giant group effort. So not one person, I don't care if they're the director or producer, everybody's involved in making a film. So you, and especially with separating, but that's where in the one director usually, that's where the credit goes, is when they're one-on-one dealing with actors, like the example you just gave. That's really hard to get those kinds of performances out and keep them riveted. So it's a combination of the actor and director.
You guys have anything you want to add to that?
No, I'm just going
to
say that for what the guy was asking, isn't it easier to do drama or to do the drama than it is action? No, and like you were saying too, because you don't necessarily know that the Russo brothers or anybody else could have gotten the same performance that Lonergan got out of Casey Affleck. He knew the story so well. He knew certain things. It's about the whole package. I do agree, though, that more movies, whether it's a John Wick 2 or these movies, should be looked at for what directors do for the overall packages. That we shouldn't just be looking at these dramas to be the ones that are nominated. Directors for overall pieces should be looked at.
I want to add, that was actually really insightful, that like for action movies, there are a lot more irons in the fire, whereas dramas are more of a result of the director and the actor one-on-one, so the director hands-on does more. That was actually very cool. But I do agree, man, like one of the biggest snubs is like, I really think The Dark Knight should have been looked at. Nolan should have been looked at for best director, because if you look at that, taking everything in account that everyone here addressed, that still qualifies completely. So it's not to be discounted, but I do agree, generally speaking, the Academy does look at drama.
All right, guys, well, I said we'd save some time for your live Twitter questions, and we're gonna do that right now. Wendy, what have you picked out?
All right, the first one comes from Bazinga Guy, who writes, thoughts on Hollywood Reporter report saying 60% of Americans can't name one Best Picture nominee.
I try to tell people this in our fan circles a lot too. It's like you were bringing up about Simon Kinberg. It's like, of course, probably everybody who watches this show, we all know who Simon Kinberg is, because we forget, because that's because we travel in these circles. When I try to tell people and says, everybody knows who Nightwing is. No, they don't. Right. Everybody in our circles know who Nightwing is.
Some people didn't know what Rogue One was until the week before it came out.
There was a man on this show, after I said, it's Wolverine, looked at me, and Michael Rapaport was like, I do. He just says it like, oh, it's Wolverine. The dude didn't know who Wolverine was, you know? So, it all depends on the circles you travel in.
So I'm not shocked. I'm not shocked to hear that at all. I mean, especially since I don't think there's any really big key blockbusters that got nominated this year. So, I mean, there have been years where films like Django Unchained and other significant blockbusters did, but this year there's none of those. So I'm not surprised to hear that. What about you guys?
Not surprised at all.
No, not at all for me either. It's as simple as that. Like, nope, not at all.
All right, what's next?
All right, this one comes from Goose Clues, who writes, for those of you who have seen Get Out, what are your thoughts?
We got a review going up a little bit later today. I really enjoyed the film. I do think the first half of the film has some pacing. The setup is they took a little too long with their setup. The setup felt dragged out a bit. Then once they actually got into the meat of the movie, I really got engaged quite a bit.
That's funny. I kind of feel the opposite of that. I thought the first half to me was super engaging. I enjoyed the movie. It was super engaging. I thought for first directorial debut, really, really should be something he's proud of. I thought it was a little predictable. I thought there was a lot of times you go, oh, well, that's going to happen, that's going to happen. But it's engaging. I thought the performances were great. It's a really good, it's a standout movie for February for sure.
It's fun.
Yeah.
That we're talking about directing, engaging with the actors. Some of the performances in this movie are incredible.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's some really cool scenes where the acting is so top-notch that it's like, it's, it brings you moments of real creepiness.
That's what I was going to say. I said it does creepy very well.
Yeah, super creepy yet funny at the same time. Some legit scares.
Yeah.
It's a really nice little film. I think people should go and see it. All right, what's next?
The next one comes from KDJ, who writes, there are 7 Marvel-related films being released in 2018 between Marvel, Fox, and Sony. Can the market handle all that output?
Yes.
Yeah, hell yes.
Have been so far.
Yeah. Yes. Wait till you see Logan, and then you'll rephrase that question. Can't we get 16 of these done in a year? You
know, I mean, I keep bringing this example up, and people keep saying to me, John, it's not the same thing. Yes, it is the same thing. What's one of the big popular shows on television right now, weekly television shows?
Game of Thrones.
Okay, well, like Game of Thrones. It's like you're going to get 8 episodes of that every year. Is that oversaturating Game of Thrones? No. People like it and it's good, we will watch it week after week after week. Put out 8 Marvel films in a year, that's less than 1 a month. If people enjoy them and they're good, once a month is not oversaturating. Right. So I personally feel, now if they're bad, it's going to feel like one's coming out every other hour.
Sure.
But if they're good, it's going to feel like an eternity between them. So I think it'd be just fine.
Yeah, it's how much TV can you think of where you look at it, you're like, every episode's kind of the same shtick, but it went on for like 10 seasons. So, I mean, it's not like a new phenomenon where people are like, oh, yeah, 10 chapters of that a year. So, people are going to still watch it. People are going to watch it, and half those people who watch it and like it are going to complain about how it comes out too often, and then they'll keep watching it. It'll be fine.
It's not too much if it keeps making money.
Right.
And if it's still good. Yep. If it's good, it's not too much.
The reason why it's making money is because they're good. I mean, you could have, like, the argument, well, Transformers, but you only get Transformers 1 in every 3 years. It's not consistent, the same brand doing it. If the reason why the X-Men movies, whatever you think about Apocalypse, Spider-Man, all the MCU movies, like, the reason why is because, you even look, Deadpool, all these movies are getting better. They're doing, and we talked about this when we talked about Logan. You've got to switch things up. Same way that Deadpool switched things up, definitely the way that Logan switched things up. As long as they keep switching things up and don't make it the same type of thing, they'll keep making money and they'll keep making more of them, and we won't feel oversaturated.
Right. I don't think the word fatigue, even though there's more superhero films now than ever before, is in play until we have like 3 or 4 consecutive ones that just are not good.
All right. What's next?
The next one comes from Elijah M. Turner, who writes, with aging technology taking the forefront, will you be sad to see the art of makeup effects becoming a thing of the past?
I honestly don't think you're ever going to see makeup effects a thing of the past. I mean, makeup effects could have been a thing of the past years ago, but they're not. Practical effects could have been done away. I mean, we had the ability to make entire movies just in front of a green screen, a la Sin City. We've had the capability to do entire movies just in front of a green screen for decades, and yet we still use practical effects and stuff like that. I don't think we're ever going to see the art of makeup go away.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I don't think so.
Yeah,
no, I mean, especially when you have the synthesis of the art of makeup. Look at any episode of Walking Dead. Most of that is actual practical zombies where they add CG when the heads explode and all stuff like that. So I think the combination of practical and CG is the best usage.
All right, last question of the day.
All right, last one comes from Darren Pearman, who writes, it's Pearman. With Fate of the Furious being 2 hours and 40 minutes in length, is it too much too long?
I didn't even know that.
I had not even heard that at all.
Can we fact check that on IMDb or something?
Yeah, sounds wrong. Somebody can look that up. That's like, yeah, too much too long.
2 hours and how?
40 minutes?
That's way too many car scenes.
I don't think that's...
That can't be right.
No.
Sometimes when you look, if you look at like runtime on Google and it gives you... It's always wrong.
Right.
It is. I don't know if that's what happened, but
240? That's impossible.
What is it?
Ben Hur? 140 is actually, you know, that's an... That's a,
did you say
2 hours and
I bet you about 210.
Minutes.
I bet you it's about 210.
That's still too long.
Did you say 2 hours and 40 minutes or 240 minutes?
That's what the guy wrote.
Why can't I find this movie on IMDb?
She
said 2 hours and 40 minutes. I mean, if that's the case, let's just say it is 2 hours 40 minutes. No one needs to be. I mean, that's you're gonna feel like you got hit in the head with a hammer 87 times after this.
Well, Dark Knight's 2 hours 40 minutes.
Dark Knight is not.
I agree. Right. No, I agree. Yeah. I'm just like throwing out.
No,
like,
there's
a
movies
movie that was.
Should be that yeah, long. Right. It could be that long, and you know, it's the same type of genre. If the Avengers turns out to be 220, 230, that's okay because we've built to that.
Yeah, sleep in the curious. That's what I'm gonna call it.
What's that, Wendy?
I'm looking at IMDb. I somehow can't find the runtime for some reason, but people in the chat room. It's 160 minutes.
Yeah, which is 2 hours and 40 minutes.
Yeah, my that's Lord. Super long.
I'm looking at
IMDb's not always correct, so it could change. Well, I mean, maybe.
I'm reading on Slash Film right now. They've got a report that says, and also Screen Crush is reporting it as well, that it's 160 minutes. It's coming from a tweet. I don't recognize the name of the person who says, I was at the screen last week. I can confirm it's 160 minutes. If it's 160 minutes, that's stupid.
That's crazy.
Some movies need to be that long. A Fast and the Furious movie needs to be like 100
90
minutes.
I
yeah, like say, maybe yeah. 100 minutes is how long a Fast and Furious. This sounds ridiculous. Maybe
but just is this the 40- last one?
No, they got like 11 more coming.
Right. Maybe it has 40 post-credit scenes. You don't know.
It's the drama of Vin turning against the family.
Right. Charlize Theron's in it.
This is ridiculous. If that turns out to be, I cannot verify that that's true or not.
If that's true, I want to see a 40-minute car chase. Yeah. Right. Just the most ridiculous, over-the-top.
Foot chase. 40-minute foot chase.
I would like a 40-minute foot chase followed by the for like 5 minutes and then get in the car and then 40 minutes.
Yeah, a 7-minute scene of Ludacris trying to decide what to order at McDonald's.
Right. I want to see that. If they made an extremely stupid cut like that, I would watch it.
All right, guys. That'll do it for us for this installment of Movie Talk. Thank you so much for joining us. I want to thank the guys sitting at the table with me. First of all, sitting over there, Mr. Jon Schnepp. Schnepp, where can people find you?
I'll be working on my 7-hour super boring film coming at you tomorrow. I'm going to shoot it all digitally at Jon Schnepp on Facebook and all the other friend places. Whatever.
Jeremy Jahns.
Good sell.
You can find me at, yeah, that was a solid sell. You can find me at Jeremy Jahns on YouTube, Twitter, the rest of the internet. You can find my show Awesome Tacular on the Verizon Go 90 network. Episodes are about 22 minutes long, not 160.
Mr. Kristian Harloff.
You can find me at Twitter and Instagram at Kristian Harloff. And I have to say thank you to all you guys out there. The Roka and Merle match has over 255,000 views, woo-hoo, over its 11,000 likes, and you guys, thank you so much. Really glad that you enjoyed it. Keep on watching the Schmodown. We have a lot of great matches coming forward in season 4.
Over there, Miss Ashley Mova.
Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Ashley Mova. Happy Wednesday, guys.
And Wendy Lee.
On YouTube at the Movie Couple channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And you guys can simply follow me on Facebook and on Twitter at John Campea. That'll do for us, guys. Thanks so much for joining us, and until next time, bye-bye.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.